Okay. Then let's continue with the last presentation until the barbecue starts outside. So my name is Thorsten Kuckuck. I'm the senior architect for the enterprise server at SUSE. And I want to tell something about transactional updates, why we are doing this, how this is working. But first, 2 years ago, there was a nice article in a German magazine, which roughly translated is, before a basketball play started, the scoreboard didn't work. So they decided to reboot the Windows machine responsible for the scoreboard. And what happened is, during the reboot, Windows started to apply all updates. And this took quite a long time. And the game started only 17 minutes too late. While they still won the game on the green table, later they lose it. And because they lose it, they were even relegated in a lower division. And it's all due to a Windows update. And this is where I said, I will never want to read that my basketball team is relegated to a lower division because of Linux. So, and now why I'm talking about this. Distributions with rolling updates. If you look at OpenSUSE Factory, the mailing list after a really big tumbleweed update release is done, you will always see similar problems. And one question, for example, is how do I make intrusive updates to a system while I'm still using the system? Or how do I handle big updates? If there is a new version of KDE or GNOME and you look at its release and you look on the mailing list, there are always people having problems because they updated it while GNOME or KDE were running, and afterwards or during the process it breaks, update stops, system was in an undefined state, whatever. So that's not nice, and yes, that's something where we need to find a solution for. So what should I do if the update breaks my system? Of course, one solution is during boot, I apply the updates in a single user mode, more or less, and then afterwards reboot a second time with all the changes activated. But on the other side, I, as desktop user at home, if I'm in a hurry and want to print something, I really don't like that my machine updates, reboots twice, and during this time I cannot use it, especially if you are in a hurry. And I even hear this a lot of times from Windows users. But there are not only desktop system users, but there are also the critical mission systems, where an update shouldn't interrupt the services. And think about you are running, as we had with OpenSUSE Cubic, your cluster, you are updating Docker, and suddenly all containers will be killed and restarted. If you do this in an HPC environment, where the processes run several days, weeks, months, your customer will be really angry with you. And at the same time, the update should always fully applied or not. You don't want that there is an undefined state of the system, where you have then to debug how to fix it, whatever, it should only work. So the answer I found already quite some time before was transaction updates. If you look at other Linux distributions, it's not new. And there's even a definition about this. I more or less copied it from Ubuntu, who have something similar with their Snappy format. And in transactional update should be atomic. So either it's fully applied or not at all. And the update should not influence your running system. Also, if something goes wrong, for example, the new kernel does not detect your hard disk, video adapter, network card, whatever, you want to have an easy way to roll back to the old state which were working for you. So the first question I asked myself was, is there already something we could use for it? There are several solutions. One solution is to use several partitions. So having one partition the current system, a second partition where I install the updated system, then I boot, roll back. Some Linux distributions go that they need even 15 partitions for this, which is really a huge number and waste a lot of disk space because assume you have a root system, file system with about 2 to 4 gigabyte usage. You need minimal 10 gigabyte with free space on it. You need big disks for small systems. So I didn't want to use it. Special package format is doable, but then I would need to build up a new OpenSUSE or SUSE distribution, but I wanted a solution which I can introduce in small steps into our existing distributions without the need to change everything. Like OS 3, where you have a complete new kind of packaging, whatever, it's really nice, but it creates a lot of symlinks, and this brought me to the idea, why should I in the user land do all the work which ButterFS can already do for your own? So why should I bother with copy and write everything and emulate this with symlinks? There is ButterFS who can do it. So why so complicated? We have ButterFS as root file system. We have snapshots with rollback enabled. We have snapper, we have zipper, we have the ButterFS utilities. That's all you need. You don't need any fancy new stuff. Whatever, OpenSUSE Tumbleweed or Slash 12 will bring or have everything you need for it. If you think about how snapshots are working with Slash 12 or OpenSUSE Tumbleweed, you have your current root file system and every time you make a modification to it, you create a new read-only snapshot of the current installation and then you update the running system. If something goes wrong, you can go back and do a rollback to your clone, but if something goes wrong, it still influences your running processes, whatever. Why not doing it in another way? So, transaction updates, what we are doing. We have a lot of old snapshots, but they are not only there for reference, never used, but they are always in used at least once. And the latest snapshot is your current root file system. If you now want to create an up or make an update, we create a new read-only snapshot in the same way as with traditional Tumbleweed or Slash snapshots. But now we don't change the current root file system, but we make the read-only snapshot read-writeable. We run zipper in it. I use zipper up here example. You can also run zipper patch, zipper dub, whatever you want. After we made that, we switch back to read-only snapshot. Set it to the new default root file system. And now it's done. More we don't need. The next time you boot, the new snapshot will be booted with all your updates. This advantage is in the current root file system, you don't see the modifications. So if you have a small update like an enhancement for Vim, whatever, yes, you have to reboot to activate this update. That's one of the drawbacks of transaction updates, and that's why everybody for himself has to find out what is a better or a solution for him. So, and if you write a small script, that's all you need to do transaction updates on Tumbleweed or Slash. In the end, it will be a little bit more complex. You need to check if it worked, so if some of the step worked or not. You need to mount some proc sys file system, the dev file system, but in the end, it's not much more than this one. And there are, of course, some requisites for it. If you think about rollbacks, there is a problem if you do a rollback and you have data outside the root file system, it will not be rollbacked and you can have a difference there, a mismatch. So you strictly separate your data from your applications, else you will lose data with this kind of update. Slav SRV is a poor nightmare in this regard. So if you depend on RPMs installed there currently, then I would advise not to do transaction updates until somebody finds a solution to really separate this PHP stuff from the running code, from the data, whatever, and not put everything in one directory as it is currently. Also, you need to review the RPM pre-post install sections. They should modify data which are not on the root file system, because most of the time they are not accessible at this time. Don't create something outside of your snapshot or subvolume because it's not there. Also, don't try to fiddle around with running processes, because if you think you need to restart itself, if you restart, for example, the web server, the new web server is still the old one, it's not the new one. So don't do that. And you should be able to scope with different data formats during updates and rollback. The good thing is, this is nearly no problem. So for the OpenSUSE Tumbleweed basis installation, the RPMs are fine. For the SLES 12 base installation, the RPMs are fine. So it's really only a few RPMs which do really bad things there. And currently we have systemd and NTP who have problems, but the next update should fix them because they are making too much assumptions instead of checking if the code is really there. So, yeah. So the next problem there is data consistency. If you look at OpenSUSE Tumbleweed with a read-write root file system, if I start the snapshot and then updating it and make any modifications to the still current root file system, with the next reboot there, of course, will be reverted. Now some people always complain the data is lost. Now it is not. It's still there in the old snapshot. You can diff the two snapshots and reapply the changes you made. But of course, that's not very admin-friendly, user-friendly. So that's, if you listen to the OpenSUSE Cubic call, we decided to go with a read-only file system for OpenSUSE Cubic and CASP to make sure that this does not happen. If I have a read-only root file system, I can create a snapshot whenever I want and reboot at any time later. Nothing will be, since nothing can be changed on the root file system, nothing will be reverted there. So, but the problem is with a read-only root file system, we still have a lot of applications which are not able to scope with this. So even the minimal Tumbleweed and SLES system out of the box, so Tumbleweed now, the minimal system should work. SLES 12 SP2, the minimal system will not work on a read-only root file system. There are still too many packages which don't check what they are doing, which don't follow the file system standard, but only writing files across the system. One of these applications is systemd. I still don't know how to teach systemd to not do it in all cases, but luckily systemd is error tolerant enough that if it fails, it continues to work and it's not important in this situation. So for configuration changes, etc. needs to be write-able, which also opens a new questions. Assume you install Zamba, you make modifications to the configuration files. Now with a transaction update, you update Zamba to a newer version with an incompatible configuration file. What should you do? Some distributions try it with a three-way diff and try to find out what the admin changed on the original config and applies to the new configuration. Sometimes it works. If it's a real incompatible change, you have a really broken config file afterwards. Some, and that's what I'm currently doing, is they ignore it. So the admin has then to manually do the changes after the next reboot. And here, I really like the systemd way, how they are doing it in userlib, which is read-only. You have your original configuration file as shipped with the distributor. And in etc, you only write the changes to it. So if the configuration of systemd the default changes with the next update. After reboot, you have the new configuration of systemd, but also you have your own changes to it, and systemd is merging it for you. This was really something which I like, how they did it. And that is something which even more applications should think about, but it's a long way to go. So, and where is it already able to use transaction updates? In OpenSUSE Cubic or SUSE Container Service Platform, it's the default and only way to update your system. So, it's a rolling release, and it's working there with a read-only root file system. I have some machines now running since half a year with it, and besides systemd and NTP, which were bugs in the post-install scripts, which could also hit on Tumbleweed or Slash, but less likely, there were no problems. I also have some OpenSUSE Tumbleweed installations doing transactional updates for every snapshot since half a year. It's there available in the repository, in the official repository site sometimes if you also want to use it there and test it, try it. The only problem on Tumbleweed I run into, if a package with an extra Euler is installed, then it breaks because this tab is always interactive and transactional updates as currently implemented is non-interactive. That's something we still need to work on. So. No, I'm already at the end. Are there questions now about this? No questions? Yes? How we handle directories in VAR? If you look at OpenSUSE Cubic or CASP, if you need to write to these directories, there are own subvolumes and excluded from the root file system. So they are not available during update. And here we come to don't modify data, most time are not even accessible. So for some applications, we changed them already that they are doing conversion of data, whatever, with a systemd one-time first boot script. System service with the first boot after the update. For others, we don't have a solution yet. And some we have still on the list. For example, the CA certificates update package has problems, and I already discussed with Ludwig, we will convert them as next that they are able to scope with this. But this is something where we need to look at every package which writes into VAR if the post-install sections are fine or not. Up to today, I know NTP and the CA certificate package, which we already adjusted or in the process of adjust, and else what I'm using did work without problem. Yes? I don't understand you. You can either can hear or the microphone. It's too loud in the background.
We have a way that packages can say I need a writable volume for my package, so we can automate this stuff, so like tempfilesd.
If you need your own subvolume for this, there is a script mk subvolume from Snapper, which is creating subvolumes during installation for you. Systemd, for example, is using it. So if you need a coding example, look at systemd. And the better solution is clearly to get the subvolume into the distribution itself. But if this is not possible, you can also create in the post or pre-install section the subvolume. That's working and already done in Tumbleweed and on Slash. More questions?
What about the ugly AAA underscore base package? That's also a bad mix of runtime and data. And shouldn't we try to get rid of this and have a package that only contains a file hierarchy but no files?
So The question was about our base, ugly. It's two kinds. At first, we have the file system package, which contains the file system hierarchy. So our base itself does not really contain core directories. And yes, there are files which could be problematic, I'm not sure. The only real problem we found with our base is the passwd group and shadow file. That's why we create this new system user concept introduced currently, where we split it up our base into systemd, this user's files, and create them if needed, if installed. There is still some work to do done because the root user is still in our base. That's the next step, because we didn't want it to break everything, but working in small steps on it. And if the passwd file is removed, I'm currently not seeing any problems with our base anymore, but if it happens, then we need to look at it again.
What's your plan on getting this into SLE? Will it make? Will this be available in SP3 already?
What our plan is to actually update and SLES SP3. So SLES has some, so at first, the transaction update RPM, which is in factory, or I think it's in LEAP2, works. It's installable in SLES. But we will not support it for now, because we only are sure that the minimal system works. And in my test environment, the standard system works. But if you look at, for example, all these packages which install in SRV, they will not work. So this is nothing we can support in general, but where we need to do a lot of more homework before we can go to a general purpose file operating system and say, this is something we can support for every customer L3-wise. So currently, with CASP or OpenSUSE Cubic, we can say the packages contained there are fine, they are reviewed by us and we can support it, but we cannot say it in, or better, we know that a lot of packages, it's not the core packages, but additional packages of SLES are not fine, and so we have a support problem there.
Any other questions?
No? Okay, if there are no questions, then I think you can go out to the barbecue. Thank you.